And welcome back to another edition of Bornholm Fertility Center's live chat. In honor of National Infertility Awareness Week, we've been doing a series of Facebook live chats this month. So far, we've covered PCOS, infertility in general, and if you're interested to watch those chats, you can log on to our Facebook page, and the live chats are available there. Today, we have a super interesting topic for you all. We're going to be speaking about male infertility. I think a lot of people have a preconceived notion that infertility tends to be a female problem. However, this is far from the truth. Many cases of infertility that we treat in our clinic are actually due to a male factor. As we discussed last week, one in five couples in the UAE face infertility issues. So today we'll learn what percentage of these are actually male factor, what are the causes behind male infertility, and is it something we can treat? If you have any questions on this topic, you can comment on this video, or if you'd like to remain anonymous, please send us a private message so we can answer your question live on air. Joining our live chat today is the rock star of our clinic, Dr. David Robertson. Dr. David is Bornholm International's Group Medical Director and Consultant in Reproductive Medicine. With over 30 years of experience, Dr. David Robertson joined Bornholm Fertility Center and was closely involved in the development of our flagship center in Dubai. Dr. David provides the medical and technical lead for our clinics in Dubai and India and works to ensure that the highest clinical standards are maintained across the group. Welcome, Dr. David. It's an honor to be doing the live chat with you.
Thank you so much.
So let's start with understanding what exactly is male infertility. How would you sort of define it?
Well, male infertility is where it's the male partner is largely responsible for a couple's difficulty in conceiving. Now, when couples come to a clinic like this one, they come in and say, well, we've been married for 1 year, 2 years, 5 years, whatever, and we haven't achieved a pregnancy, and they want to find out what the reason is. And in a significant number of cases, the problem actually lies on the male side rather than on the female side. And in some cases, there's a problem with both parties.
Okay, so how common is it for male sort of infertility or, you know, low sperm count to be the reason for a couple's infertility?
It's quite common, actually. I would say that in about half the couples we see here, there's a male factor. Now, by that I mean that perhaps the sperm quality or the sperm count is not quite as good as it should be. But there may also be problems on the woman's side. But maybe in about half of those cases, so around about a quarter of the cases we see, it's actually the problem on the male side that is the primary reason as to why a couple aren't conceiving.
That's quite high.
That's quite high. And there are regional differences as well. We see quite a particularly high incidence of male factor infertility in this region.
So that leads on to my next questions. What are some of the reasons that could cause infertility in a male? And do you have any idea why in this region it's particularly higher?
Well, you've got two main reasons. I mean, the first and the most common one is some issue with the sperm quality. Now, when we examine a sperm sample from the husband, we look at a number of different parameters. So we look at the number of sperm that are there, we look at the number of sperm that are actually moving, because sperm are like little tadpoles, they swim around. Well, actually they don't swim around, they should swim in a reasonably straight line, but sometimes they do swim around, and they get confused and they can't find the egg. So we look at the number of sperm, how well they're moving, the quality of that movement, and whether or not the sperm appear to be normal shape. And you can find something wrong with any of those parameters or in all of those parameters. So the first step, obviously, is to get a sperm sample from the man and to see whether or not there's an issue there. On the other side, sometimes there's nothing wrong with the sperm, but there might be something wrong with the delivery system, if you like. And we would also see couples where there's difficulty in having intercourse, for example. There may be sexual difficulties, erectile difficulties. And it's not so much a fertility issue per se with the man, but as far as the couple are concerned, they can't achieve a pregnancy.
That makes sense. I think you sort of mentioned it, but so what sort of test can you identify, you know, male infertility? Is it a semen analysis?
So the first thing we would do is a semen analysis, and we would look at those factors that I outlined. If we find something wrong, sometimes if we don't, I mean, there may be reasons to go further. You You might want to do some blood tests on the man to check some of his hormone levels, to see the hormones that control sperm production. Mm-hmm. Another common thing is to do an ultrasound to have a look at the genitalia, the external and the internal genitalia, to see if there's any abnormality there. And further investigations, you know, like a CT scan or an MRI, may be needed in some cases. But the first step is usually the semen analysis.
And at what point, as a fertility specialist, do you tend to refer to the in-house urologist that we have to sort of examine and help the patient further?
Well, you see a lot of variation in semen analysis. So if we see very minor problems, often we are happy to deal with those ourselves. But if the sperm count is very low, or the sperm quality is extremely poor, or the sperm is completely absent, for example, then really we need specialist advice from the experts, from a urologist.
Perfect. I have a question from Mohammed. Thank you, Mohammed. He's asking, can infertility in men be resolved in case it is a lifestyle-related issue like smoking or eating unhealthy foods? Can changing my lifestyle help my sperm count improve?
Yeah, sometimes it will. I mean, I think now there's a lot of focus now on lifestyle and diet and smoking, alcohol, other medication. And there are some studies that show that following a poor diet, not getting enough exercise, being overweight or significantly underweight can negatively impact the quality of the sperm. So taking steps to correct lifestyle may well help. You can go a bit far enough, bit too far in the other direction, and one of the problems we see here sometimes is because a lot of young men nowadays are very focused on fitness and weightlifting, and they take supplements and drugs to help with that as well. And some of those supplements and some of those drugs, like steroids, can have a very significant adverse effect on sperm quality.
Right, and smoking as well, right? There's a big link about, you know.
Yeah, smoking is. Bad for sperm. It causes abnormalities in the shape of sperm, and it can cause genetic abnormalities. And shisha is even worse.
Oh wow, well, that's good to know.
And that's a regional favorite, of course, unfortunately.
Right. I know we spoke in length last week about a woman's age being very relevant as conceiving, to conceiving, as egg quantity and quality decreases as a woman gets older. But is this relevant for men as well? Does a man's age make any difference in conception?
It makes a difference up to a point. It's not as marked a reduction in fertility as happens with women. But as men get older, the sperm quality does tend to diminish. And then also the frequency of intercourse and so forth tends to diminish as well. So fertility does decline with the man's age. But of course, it's still technically possible for men to father children. I mean, Charlie Chaplin fathered a child over 19. Whether that's a good thing or not, it doesn't matter, of course, but it's possible.
So it is possible. So it's not the same way how women sort of
get. It's not as marked a decline as you see in women.
Okay. All right. Is there like an ideal healthy sperm count for a person to become a father? Like say, for example, a man does a semen analysis, what's the sort of optimum, you know, sperm count that would say, okay, you're good to go?
Well, the World Health Organization actually sets down some limits for the different things that we look at. And the lower limit of normal in terms of numbers, in terms of the sperm count, is now taken as being 15 million sperm in every mil of ejaculate. And you really want to see about 40 to 50% of those being active and moving around well. And although this will sound very strange to a lot of people, when you look at the shape of the sperm, you want to see at least 4 or 5% of those being normal.
Okay.
Now, of course, that implies then that 95% of the sperm are abnormal. But actually, if you look very closely at sperm under the microscope, you do find that that proportion are a funny shape and tend not to function very well. It's not that they make abnormal babies, they just don't work very well. We would accept at least 4 or 5% of the sperm being normal as being a normal finding. So if somebody fulfills those criteria, they're fertile.
From a textbook point of view, again, you said 15 million per milliliter. What would you consider as somebody who is facing infertility issues? What typical numbers would you see on the semen analysis?
Well, it could be anything. We might see somebody with a very high sperm count, 50 million per mil, but only one or two of them are moving, or they're all abnormal. So you can get disturbances in any one of the different parameters.
Another question from Hassan. Thank you, Hassan. I recently had a semen analysis and found out that my count is quite low. Is there any natural ways to boost sperm count? I don't know if he's talking about particular nutrition or any herbs. I don't know. Is there any natural ways to boost it?
There's a lot of anecdotal evidence about herbal remedies and so forth, and I don't think there's any real good evidence that many of these things work. There are some medications that can be used in situations where there's a low sperm count that sometimes will work. I think if somebody does a test and they find a particularly abnormal result, I think the first thing they should do is do another test, because one thing you do see is very big variations. There was some chap did a study in Australia a few years ago, and he got a few poor guys, and over a period of a month he got them to produce a sample every 3 or 4 days. And the counts go up and down, and the quality of the sperm in general goes up and down.
That's interesting.
So you don't pin everything on one test.
Just out of curiosity, just that's just the way it is.
You have a cold, you're not well, depending on the frequency of ejaculation as well, there's all sorts of parameters influencing. I mean, I'm a bit against the whole idea of focusing too much on the numbers. I sometimes think the sperm should just really be counted as being normal, not so good and bad. The absolute numbers are not always critical.
So if a couple has been trying to conceive for some time and they're not successful, what are your guidelines that are followed in terms of checking for infertility? How many months, years should they wait before actually coming to see someone?
Well, going back to the woman, actually, it's really the woman's age that determines, most importantly, what the chance of pregnancy is, assuming everything's okay.
Right.
So if we see a couple that are quite young, let's say the woman's under the age of 30, I think it's perfectly reasonable for a couple to be trying for a year or so.
Okay.
And if they haven't succeeded in that time, then perhaps they should just get some basic tests done. If they're older, if the woman's older, and particularly if she's over 35 and getting towards 40, her fertility is starting to diminish, and it might be sensible to carry out some basic tests a bit sooner, perhaps after 6 months.
Okay. That's your guidelines. We have a longer question here. They asked to remain anonymous. My wife and I have been trying to conceive for 2 years now, and I've recently been diagnosed with azoospermia. My doctor is currently treating me with medications for a few months. What are treatment options for this condition? Will I ever be able to have a child? I think this is a common condition we see at Bornholm. Maybe do you want to just start explaining what exactly azoospermia is?
Well, the word azoospermia just means no sperm.
Okay.
So it means that we get a sperm sample from the man and we find no sperm at all. Now, this is one thing where it's important to make sure that the sperm is assessed in a proper laboratory, in a fertility clinic.
Okay.
Because occasionally there can be an extremely low count, but it's not picked up in a routine analysis. You actually have to centrifuge the sample to pellet out the very small number of sperm that are there. So the assessment should be done in a fertility clinic, and then again, there should always be at least two samples, especially if you're dealing with a diagnosis like azoospermia, two or even three samples to confirm it. Now, there are two basic issues with the absence of sperm. Either there's no sperm being manufactured at all, so that implies that the testicles are not working properly and they're not actually producing sperm, or the testicles might be working fine and they might be producing sperm, but there's a blockage in the system. So the first step that any urologist, any male fertility specialist will take is to try and establish on which side the issue lies. And that involves doing a general examination, doing an ultrasound to look at the testes, doing some blood tests to check some hormone levels, and then those will give a guide as to what's happening. And treatment may well be possible for many reasons. Medication can be given that might be able to correct the problem if there's a hormone deficiency. There may be a blockage that some kind of surgical procedure might help. And in some cases, although there's no sperm in the actual ejaculated sample, you can retrieve sperm by surgical methods, using a microscope and going inside the testicle.
Okay.
So they're very often.
So it's hard to say how long treatment can last. It's very case by
case.
It
very much depends on the individual situation.
So, I mean, perfect timing, but the question came from Faisal. He's asking, what's the probability of finding sperm in a microtisa?
It really depends. Okay. I mean, it's not really possible to do that, to give an accurate figure, because it really depends on the situation. We do sometimes see men where there's no sperm, and all the tests point to the testicles having stopped working. And that's a bit like the male equivalent of the menopause, where the woman, the ovaries have stopped working completely. And unfortunately, there's often really nothing we can do about that. But those cases are relatively the minority out of all the people we see.
So how do you feel the mindset now is towards male infertility? As I mentioned in the beginning, I think a lot of people seem to just associate fertility with a female problem. And as you mentioned, it's a lot more common than we realize. So how are people sort of accepting the fact that, oh, wow, okay, it could be me, you know, that has the issue as a man? And do you feel like it's changing? Is it shifting?
Oh, it's changing a great deal, a huge amount. I mean, as I said earlier on, about half the couples we see, there's actually a factor on the male side. So the problem is there, it's undeniable.
Okay.
And so really, you know, there has to be some recognition of that. But I first worked in this region in the 80s. And in those days, the men would often just refuse to do a semen analysis.
Right.
Just said, well, it's not me.
Yeah, can't be.
It's not possible. And that's completely changed.
Okay.
And I find now that I actually very rarely encounter problems getting a man to go through tests and do a sample. I mean, nobody's going to be happy about it. I mean, the woman's not happy about having problems either. Nobody's happy with having medical problems. But people do, I think, understand much more that the problem can lie on either side.
Do you feel like there's a stigma associated with, you know, male infertility, especially in this region? And any advice on how we can address the stigma as a fertility specialist like yourself, or as a fertility clinic like Bornhall? Is there any way we can help people sort of come to terms with this?
In some cultures, I think there is a stigma. The stigma is more with childlessness.
Right.
I mean, family is very important to all of us. In some cultures, being unable to have a family really does create a lot of social problems for couples. I don't think in this region it's as much of a problem as it used to be. As I say, I think people are much more understanding about it. But I think it's up to us to
educate
people that in many cases a solution can be found. And of course, these are medical issues. It's not that somebody has done something wrong or that committed a crime of some kind. I mean, it's like you get appendicitis, or sometimes you get a problem with the testes that causes fertility issues.
Yes. Well, thank you so much, Dr. David, and thank you all for tuning in for, I feel, a very successful Another Life chat that we had. If you feel there's any more questions you'd like us to answer that we didn't cover during the last 20 minutes, please send us a message or comment on this post, and I'll get Dr. David to answer. And if it's a little more of a complicated question, we can even get one of our urologists to answer as well. We're also just want to inform, you know, anyone watching, that we're proud to be bringing in a world leader in male infertility, Dr. Oliver Wiseman, to our clinic May 6th to May 9th. And he'll be performing vasectomy reversals and microtisas of advanced sort of azoospermic cases exclusively at Bornhall Dubai. So if you're interested in learning more, you can always contact our clinic on 800-483. And next week, I would definitely get all of you to tune in. It's a super interesting session. We'll be going into our embryology lab, or as we say, where the magic happens, and speaking with our embryologists about what exactly happens in the lab. So please tune into that. And again, if you have any questions, you can always ask us, and we'll be happy to